In this video, I'm going to talk about agreement and when agreement parameters should be used in practice. Get our very own assessment ebook and mobile app. Links are in the video description. Hi and welcome back to Physiotutors. When using a measurement tool in physiotherapeutic practice, one can have several goals. You may either want to discriminate someone who is sick from someone who is healthy, you may want to evaluate a certain treatment effect, or you might want to predict a future outcome, for example, the chance for chronicity. Agreement parameters assess how close the results of repeated measurements are by estimating the measurement error in repeated measurements. So, agreement parameters are more a pure measure of the measurement instrument itself and not dependent on the variability between the subjects to be measured. In practice, this is often used to evaluate your treatment effect and to judge whether a real change has taken place or not. An example. If the weight of a person is measured on 5 different days, the 5 measurements would probably show some variation. The standard deviation between these repeated measurements represents the agreement because it answers the question, how good is the agreement between repeated measurements? Note that it remains unclear whether the measurement error between those 5 measurements originates from my way of measuring, maybe because I used to scale on a different underground each time, which we would call a systematic error, or if it comes from random fluctuations in a person, which we call random error. It can also come from the combination of the two factors. The measurement error should be smaller than the improvements or deterioration that one wants to detect. If the measurement error is large, then small changes cannot be distinguished from measurement errors. So in order to know if the person has really lost weight in these 5 days, we have to know how big the measurement error is. If the measurement error is bigger than the differences between measurements, then we cannot really say that the person has lost or gained weight. On the other hand, if the measurement error is smaller than the differences between those 5 measurements, then we can say that the person has really lost or gained weight. So how is the measurement error calculated and which values do we commonly see in scientific papers? The measurement error is the systematic and random error of a score which cannot be ascribed to a real change of the construct that the measurement instrument is trying to measure. The easiest way to calculate the measurement error is to calculate the limits of agreement. To do that, we will draw a so-called Bland-Altman plot with repeated measurements. The average of 2 measurements is depicted on the x-axis and the difference between the 2 measurements on the y-axis. So if I measure one person and he weighs 70 kilos on the first measurement and 72 kilos on the second measurement, I will put my mark on 71 kilograms on the x-axis and on 2 on the y-axis. Now imagine we do this for a lot of measurements of a stable group of persons. Then we will get a scatter plot similar to this. With a lot of values, we are able to calculate a systematic measurement error, which is expressed with the letter D for difference. So if the average of all second measurements is 100 grams higher compared to all averages of the first measurements, then the average systematic measurement error will be 100 grams, and on our D line, it will be drawn at 0.1. The distance of all points from this line represents the size of the measurement error. The closer the points are to the D line, the smaller the measurement error. Per definition, 95% of all differences between the 2 measurements lie between D minus 1.96 times the standard deviation and D plus 1.96 times the standard deviation of the dataset. The standard deviation is the measure of the spreading of the differences around the average and displays the random error of measurement. This room between the dotted lines is called limits of agreement. These are interpreted as follows. If a measurement with a certain measurement instrument is conducted twice,
The second measurement will be somewhere between D minus 1.96 times the standard deviation and D plus 1.96 times the standard deviation in 95 out of 100 cases, only due to the measurement error. If the value of the second measurement falls out of the limits of agreement, it means that it can be seen as a true change as it is bigger than the measurement error. So in our example, let's say that the mean of our weight measurements was 70 kilograms with a standard deviation of half a kilogram. Then the upper limit of agreement would be 70 plus D, so 0.1, plus 1.96 times the standard deviation, and we'd end up at around 71.08 kilograms. The lower limit of agreement would be 70 kilo plus D, which was the 100 grams, minus 1.96 times the standard deviation again. Then the lower limits of agreement would be at 69.12 kilograms. Another measure of agreement is the smallest detectable change, abbreviated as SDC, which is equal to the room between the limits of agreement. So in this case, the SDC of my scale would be 71.08 minus 69.12 kilograms, which is 1.96 kilograms, which is quite a lot for a scale. In order to judge if a measurement error is big or small, we have to determine if we can detect clinical relevant changes with this measurement error. So if a person from our data set weighs himself on different days and the weight change is smaller than 1.96 kilograms, we can probably attribute this to the measurement error. If, however, he sees a weight change of more than 1.96 kilograms on this particular scale, we can be 95% sure that a real change has occurred, as it is bigger than the SDC. Clinical relevant changes are also called minimal important change, abbreviated as MIC, or minimal clinically important difference, abbreviated as MCID. In this case, we have to know which score on a measurement instrument we consider clinically relevant and compare it to the smallest detectable change on our measurement instrument. If the SDC is smaller than the MIC, our instrument is suitable. If the SDC is bigger than the MIC, our instrument is not sensitive enough to detect clinically relevant changes and is not suitable. A very important aspect affecting agreement and reproducibility in general is standardization. A measurement protocol and training can make sure that all measurements are taken the same way by one or different assessors in order to cancel out variations in the use of the measurement instrument or in environmental factors that might influence the measurement outcome. In other words, the measurement error will be minimized. So, to sum it up, agreement parameters assess how close results of repeated measurements are by estimating the measurement error in repeated measurements. If you want to evaluate if your patient has improved after your treatment, you have to use agreement parameters. If your goal, however, is to distinguish study objects from each other, you should choose reliability parameters. Click on the video right next to me to learn more about the difference between these two terms. All right, this was our video on agreement. We hope this clarified a lot of things. If it did, please give it a thumbs up. Subscribe to our channel and turn on the notifications in order not to miss any new videos. If you still have any questions, just drop us a comment down below. This was Kai for Physiotutors. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.